Welcome back to the Law and Crime Network. My name is Bob Bianchi. I'll be with you at 4 o'clock. Like I promised before the break, we're going to have something very special. As you know, we just did the little spot on the Mojave Desert by Cathy Russon. And it's one thing to see her on film, but it's another thing to see Cathy Russon in person. Cathy, welcome to the show.
Hi, Bob.
How you doing?
Good, great.
Okay, so Cathy, let's go to the Mojave Desert thing first, since we just played that. I say to the audience all the time, it's one thing to antiseptically be listening to something in a courtroom and a completely different thing when you go out to that kind of burial site. What was your feeling like?
Eerie, sad. I felt really sad. What gets me the most as a mom is that the bottom of the crosses, what you can see on the screen right now, of the boys, there's toys, there's a toy truck, there's like a SpongeBob and a sippy cup, and that just made me really sad.
Is that something, to your knowledge, that gravesite that we just saw, is that going to be maintained, or is that just up there, you know, randomly? I mean, do people tend to it?
Well, somebody must, because it's been up there since they, you know, shortly after the remains were discovered. So that's been quite a few years now. I don't know the logistics behind that. It was actually like community supporters and friends that erected that, and Mike McStay went on the scene, but it wasn't really done by the family.
Okay, now Cathy, going back to the courtroom, myself and Gene Rossi have been commenting about a couple of things. I want to talk about that sergeant that testified, having gone in there eventually into the home for a welfare check, didn't notice anything quote unquote arise, what he said at first, but then when he had to explain to the prosecutor why it was he contacted the homicide prosecutors, he explained that families just don't disappear, leave their food, the dogs, you know, haven't eaten. Is the defense scoring points here that this investigation was botched?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that it's pretty obvious, especially also with today's testimony. But when Sergeant Tingley testified, you know, he got called for a welfare check and Mike McStay met him there. And he allowed Mike to go around the back, enter in through a window, and then come around to let him in. Just that alone I thought was strange, because this isn't the owner of the house. Sure, it's the brother of the owner, but you don't know their relationship. But he allowed him to go in. Then the two of them are in there, and Tingley just took like 6 photos, was all. But because the carton of eggs was out on the counter and there was food on a plate, 2 popcorn bowls on the couch, it didn't look to him like they just went on vacation. And so that is why he didn't see anything. There's no blood, no signs of a violent act that happened there, nothing at all. But he contacted the homicide unit because a family of 4 just doesn't walk away with their breakfast still on the counter.
Right, and leaving their dogs on a
counter. Or dinner.
Their dogs aren't taken care of, or their children, presumably at school, family just up and gone. But then they put the testimony on of the friend of Summer and Joseph, who was actually working at their house, where there was everything in plans to continue to remodel the house. I mean, boy, doesn't this seem more like an abduction to you than a family that just decided to trip out to Mexico and start a new life?
I mean, it definitely looks like that. This doesn't look like they would just like that. That would be more like they had to flee the country, run out of the house, leave everything out, you know, and there's no evidence at all to suggest that they would have any reason to do that. The friend today, the interesting thing that he said, which, you know, we all picked up on when the mother, Susan Blake, testified, is he went over there one of the days that Susan was in the house and she was cleaning the kitchen up, which she testified about before. She said she got permission from the detective to go in and do that because she wanted to throw away the food and it was rotting, it all smelled horrible, and take the garbages out. He said he got there and he said to her, oh, you're cleaning, so is this no longer like being investigated? And he was worried that she was cleaning.
Yeah, we commented on that he had better investigative instincts than the people that are paid to do that professionally. Cathy, real quick, I've been kind of fixated on this third-party guilt piece with Dan Kavanaugh. The judge precluded that information, despite we read the text messages and the very angry exchange between him and the father, you know, when they basically say, now we know what you're like, and kids know what you're like, and Summer knows what you're like. Why was it, to your knowledge, because usually third-party guilt claims, if anywhere near possibly substantiated, are allowed in court, why did the court disallow it in your mind, and does it make a big difference that the defense is not getting it out? They're trying, but the judge is stopping it.
I don't know why specifically he's not allowing some. He's allowing some in about Dan Kavanaugh, but not those messages. And I'm trying to get my hands on today the motion in limine and the judge's order on that so we can get some more details on it. But they talked about it a little bit today. After they sent the jury out and was on break, they actually just briefly talked about, we didn't have our camera on, that the defense wanted to get in with McCarver, wanted to get in a conversation that that this MacGyver said him and Joseph had about Dan Kavanaugh, and that he's told that to the police. So it was in the police report that MacGyver told the police that he talked to Joseph, and Joseph was trying to get rid of Dan Kavanaugh. He didn't want him in the business anymore, and he was trying to buy him out and may have been close to buying him out, and that MacGyver said to Joseph, well, you know that that's not going to go well. You know how he is. You know his temper. Well, that's not going to come in now. That was what was told to the police. But now there's some hearsay in there, but the defense was arguing, no, this is what MacGyver himself says he said to Joseph McStay. So that's not hearsay if he can say that line, and the judge won't allow it.
Wow. Cathy, you know, we always talk about trying the case to be successful on appeal. Gene and myself think there have been some rulings right now that jeopardize the potential of a conviction. Let me ask you, when you're in that courtroom, we all do this. We're all gaming the case. It's a very well-lawyered case on both sides from what we can see. But what is the over-under right now on whether or not the state's meeting its burden or if the defense is really doing some damage here?
I try to look at it from the jury's point of view. I know too much, and I've been doing this too long to not have some sort of opinion. And so I try to look at it from their point of view. I still think it looks weak.
Wow.
The prosecution's doing a good job on that the checks were made out to Charles Merritt and then deleted, and then he cashed them anyway, and they were backdated. You know, there's things like that, and that they think they say that's the truck on the video that night, but the defense is going to come right back at that. So as of right now, I think there's reasonable doubt.
Yeah, and let's not forget that one thing that the judge is allowing in is Kavanaugh, not the statements, but that he was doing some stuff with money as well with the PayPal accounts, as I understand it. So that has...
One other thing. Mm-hmm. One other thing they talked about when he wanted to bring in that statement, they said no, the judge will allow the defense. He said he would allow him to at least bring up that MacGyver knew that Dan Kavanaugh sold the business.
Right. Well, listen, Cathy, thank you so much. I see that the weather is not necessarily cooperating, but you did a great job. And thanks so much for all the data that you're giving us here at Law and Crime. And we'll catch you soon.
Thanks, Bob.
Okay, you take